فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحومك الطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillah. All praise is always indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter what condition we are upon, it is indeed the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we beseech, that we seek, that we follow, that we would like to ask for, and indeed therefore we praise Him, because through the praising of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we will be able to achieve His mercy. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all those during or through the generations who have come to us or who have brought the goodness to us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every one of us and our offspring, those to come up to the end. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. Ameen. I commence by saying that if we would like tenfold the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala each time we send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we would achieve that. A loser is the one who hears the name of Rasulullah and does not say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So each time today and every other day when we hear the name of Muhammad, we should say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The strange point I want to raise is when I visit certain places that are poor, in some parts of Africa, I notice that they give so much of importance to the name of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we hear a huge buzz as soon as you say that name. Let's revive that, because indeed it shows our love to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So don't be ashamed, don't be shy to say it slightly louder with a little voice where everyone knows there is a hum that is uttered and we know what is being said. Today we will hear this blessed name Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so many times. Before we get up, we would have had thousands of blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed it is a sign of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it shows that we love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself as well. I want to start off also with another very interesting point regarding the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No Muslim on earth would not be loving Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No Muslim hates Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because they would not be Muslim if that was the case. But each one shows his love in his own unique way, and we should not belittle the way people show their love. What this means, and I'm going to draw an example for us to understand, if a man has four sons, for example, and as he grows older, one becomes a doctor, the other one is an alim, maybe he has studied the deen, one did not find a job, and one is a businessman who's very, very rich. Now, each one of those four loves their father. They love their father so much. And the one who's a doctor comes and says, "You know what, Dad, every time there is anything wrong, I will be the one taking care of your health matters. Anything medical, I will do. You come for a checkup every 6 months, every year, or whatever it is, and I will make sure that all this is done. And whatever you need, I'm going to make sure, because I love you so much, you come first." Subhanallah. The other sons cannot say that because they are not medically qualified. But the one who's a businessman will say, "Dad, every month I will give you a check of 50,000 rands. You do what you have to with that. I am not worried. You are my father. I love you the most. And you know what? 50,000 rands is yours every month." I hope we had sons who did that, mashallah. So that is his love. He has the money. He doesn't have something else. So he's offered what he has. And he will never insult his father. But what he's been given and blessed with, he gives. Then you have the one who's unemployed. He's neither a doctor nor is he a businessman. And what happens? Subhanallah. He comes and says, "You know what, Dad? I tell you something. You live with me. I'll take care of you. I'll take you where you want to go. I will come. I will go," and so on and so forth. And the fourth one, in his own way, also says, "Dad, you know what? I will help you, assist you, I will ensure so many different things. Let's sit every day together, I will teach you what I have, and we can give and take. He's an alim, and subhanAllah, he looks after his mom in his own way. Every single one of them has shown their love to the father. Not a single one can say, I love my father more. Or, you don't love your father. The problem with us in the ummah is, when someone shows their love to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in a way different from ours, on condition that it is something permissible and taught by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, sometimes we become upset and we say, this man doesn't love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I give you some examples. Some people show their love by trying to live their life as best as possible according to the exact way that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam lived his life. So the beard is grown, it's a sign of the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The clothing is changed, it's a sign of the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When it comes to something like salah, we would like to be on time every time, give importance to the adhan, give importance to the masjid. That's a sign of the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When you spend a lot of time, effort and energy learning the Quran, it's a sign of the love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When you spend time learning his life and attending events or programs where we are going to learn more about him and his life, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it's a sign of love. We are here today to show not only that we love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but to prove that we will follow his example as best as possible. Some might choose, like Hassan ibn Thabit, Abdullah ibn Rawaha radiyallahu anhum, Ka'b ibn Malik, these were the poets, the munshideen. They used to come out with beautiful poems in out of their love of the deen and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And there are so many, we may hear of some and we may not know some. We should study these and we can come up with our own in order to express our love to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So this would be in the form of singing the praise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That is also showing love. It is one aspect of it. Remember, never belittle someone who is showing a different aspect of the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We are not perfect human beings. In fact, human beings will not be perfect. The perfection was for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, granted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for us, we will keep trying. You know, when they say the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it is so vast, it is so wide, so broad, that only he was able to fulfill every aspect. That's why it's his sunnah. As for us, even the best from amongst us, we will only be able to fulfill a limited number of aspects of that sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. So never say someone does not love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, if they are going wrong, we can correct them in a beautiful way. That correction should also be according to the method of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's an automatic gift for us to be following the sunnah even while correcting people. Now let's start off right at the beginning. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. That birth was a gift for all of us, every one of us.
لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا.
Indeed, Allah had favored the believers when He sent to them a messenger. It is the favor of Allah. So if someone asks you what is the biggest favor that you have, it is the fact that you have iman and you are a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The biggest favor. Hold on to it. Learn about it. Teach your children. Live by it. Because more important than giving lip service to your children about how important it is to fulfill your deen and to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is actually to fulfill it yourself, so that they watch you and they fulfill as you do. The most successful parents are those who lead by example. The most successful parents are those who lead by example. They practice what they preach. How many of us are prepared to do that? That is also a sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So let's start making resolutions for today. A mental note, inshallah, we need to practice what we preach. We need to be role models for our children. We need to be people who can pass the baton on. Look at the globe and look at the disasters across the globe. Wallahi, the solutions of the problems of the globe depend on how closely you are following the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We cannot be seeking solutions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yet the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who was sent to us, we are far away from what he has taught, yet that is what the solution was. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding, and may Allah grant us a love such that we feel it in our hearts for one another. Ameen. He was born, that was a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for every one of us. We thank Allah for that. And at the same time, the conditions surrounding his birth, some of these we learn such deep lessons that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept in them, that it would change the way we look at things sometimes. And we all know when he was born, what had happened to his father? He had passed away prior to the birth. Imagine the most loved unto Allah. That is something we firmly believe. He is afdalul khalqi wa akramul rusul, without a doubt. The best of creation, the most noble of all prophets of Allah. Imagine when you say the best of creation, have you thought about what that means? The best of creation, better than the angels, subhanallah. Better than Jibreel, alayhi salatu wassalam. And in fact, the most noble of all the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including Isa alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam, he is the highest. And Allah chose that when he was born an orphan. Allah chose that for him. La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What good news is that for those who may think they were disadvantaged at birth because they didn't have a father or they lost their mother, yet it is an advantage. Subhanallah. It is a sign of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It does not mean you're going to fail. The first lesson that I learn when I look at the birth of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to appreciate the orphan child. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us about the treatment that we give to those who are orphaned or those who are widows. So much so that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself has said, أنا وكافل اليتيم كهاتين في الجنة. Myself and the one who looks after an orphan shall be like these two fingers in Jannah. Remember, it's easy to read that, but when you start thinking he was an orphan, you look at it differently. Imagine he's saying me, and someone who takes care of those who were like me will be in Jannah together. That's the whole reason why they will be in Jannah. He was also an orphan, subhanallah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The most loved by Allah. The one whom when we hear his name, if we don't say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have in fact insulted ourselves and cursed ourselves. Subhanallah. Yet he was born an orphan. So good news to those who have had a beginning that was filled with challenges. Because after a little while, he lost his mother, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A few years later, we hear this every year. We look at it, we understand it, we hear it, we listen to it. But have we ever paused and thought about going out of our way to take care of orphans? Going out of our way to take care of those who've lost their mothers? Going out of our way to take care of the widows? For the sake of Allah and Allah alone? And earning Jannah? You have love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Go back and look at those who are orphaned and tell yourself, if Allah chose for His most beloved to be like this at the beginning, then surely for me to look after such children would actually be my stepping stone towards earning the intercession of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of judgment. May Allah grant that to us. Say Ameen. So my beloved brothers and sisters, remember, when you have a soft spot in your heart for those who are orphans, widows, those who are disadvantaged, those who may have lost a loved one, and when you take care of them, when you reach out to them, when you give them a good word, you find Allah. You find Allah. If you want to find Allah, you will find Allah where the brokenhearted are. You will find Allah where the sick and those who are elderly are. Those who need help are. Because if Allah wanted, He could have done for them every single thing without needing anyone else. But He wanted to give an opportunity for those with the greatest of hearts to take care, to rise to the occasion, to earn an act of worship, a reward through it, so that they can get their Jannah. So Allah kept the sickly, the elderly, those who are disadvantaged, the poor, etc. Imagine there were no poor. How would we be earning through giving? You wouldn't need to give. According to one of the narrations, a time will come when there'll be so much wealth on earth that no one will accept zakat. You go and give a man and he'll say, I've already got bitcoins, you can keep your money. May Allah forgive us. There will come a time when there will be so many people with wealth, your money will be rejected. So spend before that time. There will come a time, subhanallah, when the way we are worshipping Allah today may not be as easy. It is happening already across the globe. So while you have the opportunity, worship Allah. Worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the best possible way. Imagine if there was no one who was sick and ill. How would we be able to earn the reward when Allah says, you heard about so and so who was ill? And we say, yes. And then He says, well, had you gone there, you would have found me there. Subhanallah. So make an effort. Put your phone aside for a moment. It's a disease that all of us are involved in to different levels, myself included. We need to put it aside and do something real to earn Jannatul Firdaus. Wallahi, go in your community, search for the people, look for those who are in need. The true people in need don't show that they're in need. You might find a person next to you every day, you haven't even greeted him. And yet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Ala adullukum ala amrin idha fa'altumuhu tahabbtum afshu salama bainakum." Should I not show you something if you were to practice upon it, it would increase the love and the mahabba among you? How many of us would like to see that? How many of us would like to see the love and the mahabba spread amongst us? Every one of us. Well, if that's the case, you start off with the first step of greeting the people and meaning it. Assalamu alaikum, mashallah. And you smile, subhanallah. You've earned a lot. I promise you, a smile is not an act of charity for nothing. It's a sadaqah for a reason. Because the power of it is way beyond anything material. Remember this. Try it out. You find a person who looks so difficult. They look so stern. And the next best thing, they smile at you. Subhanallah. All the barriers are broken. You can greet. You feel close. You feel a connection. Through what? Showing your teeth. Subhanallah. Smiling. Even if you haven't shown the teeth, but at least you've broken into a smile. So it's not something cheap to say, smiling is a sunnah. There is no sunnah on earth, no matter how small it is, that someone can say, this is insignificant. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May Allah strengthen us. My brothers and sisters, I want to tell you something very important before I go ahead. Came to my mind right now. Anything we say about the deen is connected to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anything we say about Islam, about salah, about the pillars of Islam, about the pillars of iman, about the do's and the don'ts, no matter what you want to say, is connected to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He receives a reward as we are talking right now, and we receive a reward. And at the moment, the angels are surrounding us. The rahmah of Allah is descending upon us. Allah is mentioning us, subhanallah, to the angels. And at the same time, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is achieving a full reward of anything and everything we do. Every salah that is read, every act of worship that is engaged in, every act of goodness that is engaged in, he receives a full reward. Look at how his rank is elevated to the highest of the high. So thank Allah. Today we are seated here because of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's effort, what he did and how he taught, and he was chosen by Allah. He brought everything to us. So don't forget this. We owe it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nothing that you want to do to earn closeness to Allah can you do without going through Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's teachings. Remember this. What a great gift of Allah. And this is why anyone who involves himself or herself in anything to do with the deen has involved himself or herself with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You want to get closer to him? Involve yourself somewhere, in whatever way you can. Like I said earlier, some people can give differently from others. You might be able to give your time. Someone gives their wealth. Someone gives their expertise. Someone sits and makes dua because perhaps that's the only thing they could do. Now, when you have a big capacity, don't just sit back and say, you know what, I'll just make dua. No, wait. If Allah's given you something greater than that, you need to know that's your test. Where are you going to take what you have now? If you are a top doctor, for example. Where are you going to take that? When you die, it's gone with you. Unless you have passed something on, unless you've helped people. If you're a very wealthy person, what are you going to do with that wealth? It's not even going to come with you in your grave. As for your offspring, they come with their own sustenance, written by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So go back to the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and see. Look at what he tells. For example, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu, when he felt he was on his deathbed, and he says, "O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I have a lot of wealth and I've only got one daughter." At that time he only had one daughter. So he says, "I want to give my wealth in charity." The Prophet ﷺ says, "No, don't give all of it." He says, "Well, then I give half of it." He says, "No." He says, "Well, then I give a third of it." So the Prophet ﷺ says, "Athuluthu wa thuluthu kathir." Yes, you give a third and that's enough. So to give out a third of your wealth, subhanallah, and leave your heirs wealthy is also part of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let's go beyond the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I drew one example and I drew a few lessons from it. And I pray that every one of us from this moment, when we hear the term orphan, we look at it differently. And we go out and search for those who are orphans. Minimum is to put your hand on the head of that orphan. Wallahi, there is a hadith that speaks about that action in particular and how beloved it is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have we done it? Have we shown some form of kindness? Inshallah, we do from this day on. The second aspect that I want to speak about is that of the friends of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from a very young age. Today, we have a crisis. What is the crisis? We have drugs on one hand. We have gambling on the other. We have the clubs. We have so many gangs and gangsters. We have people who are doing all sorts of things. And mashallah, we also have a lot of good. We must never lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Allah will bring all of them back to the path if He wishes. And never think that you are safe from the plot of the devil, no matter how pious you think you are. Because the only time you can be guaranteed that you are safe from the plot of the devil is when you are given your books in your right hand. If you've passed away with iman, you have succeeded. We hear of the story of the one who worshipped Allah for 70 years, then he turned, he had a bad death. The one who was disobedient for 70 years, then he turned, he had a good death. So remember, when we see others, perhaps who may not be on a line that we would like to see them upon, go back to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We're talking about the seerah. We're talking about aspects of his life, subhanallah. When the kuffar of Quraysh, who were disbelievers, when they used to want to ask him a question, he used to want to answer it so much that sometimes you find some of his companions felt, subhanallah, look, he's giving preference to these people. But his idea was in fact to ensure that they get the message, because to win them over was what he wanted. One person coming onto the right path. We should be equally interested in trying to guide those perhaps who are misguided. We should be equally interested. Sometimes they are in our families. A lot of us, out of what we think is our own piety, we write off people. We say, write off, gone. Have you followed the sunnah? Have you understood the seerah? Have you looked at what the Prophet ﷺ did? He kept on trying and kept on trying and kept on trying. And guess what? The results came in years later. In some cases, instantly. But in a lot of cases, it was the victory of Makkah. The victory of Makkah that brought about so many people, thousands, who accepted Islam by one good deed. What was the good deed? He gathers Quraysh sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and those were the people who had killed his companions and some of his family members, and those were the people who had driven them out of their homes, those were the people who usurped their property, those were the people who did so much of harm and evil against the Muslimin. They had prepared armies and drove to Medina in order to attack the Muslimin. And yet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the day he was on a level of strength that they could see, He asks them a question, Ya ma'shara Quraysh, ماذا تظنون أني فاعل بكم? O people of Quraysh, what do you really think I'm going to do to you today? Obviously, you're seeing a ruler with more than 100,000 with him. And what are they doing? They're ready to take instruction from him. If he said, go for them, they were wiped out. Easily. Let's go back to the seerah. Wallahi, we are not prepared to do this to our own brothers and sisters at times. And then we want to be considered for the intercession of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have to do something big in your life. You have to do something massive in order to be able to achieve that love of Allah and that intercession of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Something you did not want to do, but it was so noble and it was part of the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you did it in order to earn the pleasure of Allah. So Quraysh, at that stage, they couldn't say much. What would they say? They had good hope, that's all. I mean, if a man is there, he's got all his guns and everything, and he's telling you, what do you think I'm going to do to you? You're going to say, I think you're a good man. I think, you know, I hope that you're going to do something decent, because that's the best you could ever say. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, اِذْهَبُوا فَأَنْتُمُ الطُّلَقَى. He says, you can go. You are free. لَا تَثْرِيبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْيَوْمِ. I tell you what my brother Yusuf alayhi salam told his brothers. No retribution against you today. You can go. You are free. He didn't talk to them about the deen. He didn't talk to them about converting, reverting, nothing. What happened? As a result of that deed, you see the people entering the fold of Islam, one after the other. They could not believe. That was not their system. The system of Jahiliyyah was, one man attacks one, you kill another 10. But that's not Islam. This is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is how we would achieve the forgiveness of Allah. I don't want to ask you something very, very difficult to do. All I'm saying is today is a day we're looking into the life of the most beloved of Allah. Are we prepared to do what he did to the kuffar of Quraysh, to the Muslimin who are related to us in our own families, whom we've had a dispute with over a lot of the times wealth. A lot of the times argument between the women or the men. Or sometimes wealth, a misunderstanding, a mistake, some bad habit someone might have had. We must make an effort to reconcile. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will definitely grant us. So going back to the aspect of the friends of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of his best friends, if not his best friend, was a man known as Abdullah ibn Uthman radiyallahu anhu. Do you know that? Abdullah ibn Uthman radiyallahu anhu was the closest to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So close that even later on, he was the first man to accept Islam. Now, some of you might be looking at me a little bit surprised. Abdullah ibn Uthman, who is that? Abdullah ibn Uthman, he was known as Abu Bakr ibn Abi Quhafa radiyallahu anhu. I said Abdullah ibn Uthman intentionally because a lot of us don't know his proper name. So I thought perhaps we might educate ourselves today to say Abu Bakr was a kunya. It was just a pen name given to him. And his proper real name was Abdullah, Abdullah ibn Uthman. So now all of us whose name is Abdullah, mashallah, we know that that name was also the name of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. His father was called Abu Quhafa. But Abu Quhafa's name was actually Uthman. They all had names like that. So it's interesting for us to know this. He was so close to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Guess what? He never ever drank alcohol even prior to Islam. Just like Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam never touched alcohol even prior to Islam. Although the entire community and society was involved in it, or most of the people were. It was something they traded in like no man. Subhanallah, no man's business. But my brothers and sisters, this goes to show how we need to learn a lesson. Your friends make you. Your friends. He had the best of friends. When he married against all odds. Someone who was older than him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Someone who asked for his hand in marriage. Things that we would consider today. Oh, is that what happened? Ah, you see, these guys, look at what they're doing. Go back to the sunnah. Go and check. Do you know what? His choice of a spouse was so blessed that the day he came with Nubuwwah, she did not doubt him a single bit. How many of us, our wives, do not doubt us a single bit? Subhanallah. Every other day, we receive problems of people who, subhanallah, the wife looks at your phone, and next thing, Qiyamah is there. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us steadfastness. We shouldn't have anything to hide. His wife, Khadija bint Khuwaylid, radiyallahu anha, wallahi, when he came down and he asked her to hug him, subhanallah, that is mentioned. How many of us, when you have an issue, you come to your wife and say, hug me, hug me. I don't think we do that. Would we? You have an issue, you have a problem. When you come home, you're like a devil. You say, get out of my sight. You don't know I've had issues at work today. That's how we operate. But when you have had something big happen to you, come home and you're supposed to get that comfort and you that embrace helps. You embrace, subhanallah, it helps. She didn't doubt him at all. And so when he told her what happened, she said, hang on, let's go to this cousin of mine. I take you to him. Allah will never let you down. You are such a good man. Allahu Akbar. This was prior to Nubuwwah. This was just at Nubuwwah, in fact. Subhanallah. Imagine a wife saying, he is a very good man. Subhanallah. May Allah make us from those. May Allah make us from those. Say Ameen. I see the Ameen was so soft initially. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those whom our wives can bear witness that we are top people. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, khayrukum khayrukum li ahli, wa ana khayrukum li ahli. He says, the best from among you are those who are best to their wives. And on top of that, he says, you know what? I want to tell you, I am the best from all of you to my own. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. What a great sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That brings us to another aspect. And that is the issue of being good within your home, being the best you can to your family members. The term ahl, although primarily may refer to the wife, it includes family members. It includes family members. So the friends you make, very, very important to let them be those whom you would like to be like. Those who have habits and characteristics that you would be proud of. Your friends make you or break you. Wallahi, when we go to the Quran and we see the verses of the Quran and the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaking about friends and friendship, and we look at it and we don't take it seriously, we are the losers. Every time you see a person with a bad habit, I have actually asked people questions. You know what? Tell me more about your friends. When you see them in a deep hole, you ask them about their friends are in a deeper hole. Mostly. You need to befriend good people. You need to make an intention that you will be a good person to your friends. You need to make that intention. This is when we will have hope again, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in our own future. Change your friends. Look at the youngsters on drugs, for example. They have to do it together with their friends. Really, would you find someone? And friendship includes those whom you befriend online. Today you have to be very careful whom you befriend online. You have a person who doesn't go out of the house. Do you have any friends? No. Online, there's no answer because I don't even know how many friends I have. Online. Subhanallah. Do you know that your friends online are actually not necessarily even real people? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Come to the masjid for salah. Interact, greet the people. It's part of your deen. It's part of the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When they arrived in Madinah Munawwara, what happened? Masjid Quba. First thing they thought about. They didn't think about, guys, let's start our business, let's do this, that. That was secondary. First thing was the masjid. When they arrived in Madinah Munawwara, first thing was the masjid. The people were brought together. There is love between us. Today, we are seated here in large numbers. I want to tell you, if you do not feel the love in your heart for all those who are here, there is something wrong with you. We will have differences. By all means, we will. But our deen is based on mahabba. The verse of the Quran tells that to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains to us how important it is to be Ra'ufun Rahimun, his qualities obviously, but we too need to be filled with love when it comes to the believers. We have to. We are part of an ummah, part of a family. We will be resurrected with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not on our own, but with the ummah, with the entire ummah. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us ease. So as I say, if you look at every single aspect of the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and pause after that and draw a lesson from it in order to be able to practice upon and learn from, to adopt in your life, that is when you will be truly successful. We have read the seerah. We know the aspects of the seerah. We sometimes know our facts, the dates and so on. It's important to know all of that. It's part of our heritage. It's part of our deen. We must know the names of the people. We must know the names of the mother, the father of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the lineage. The more you know, the better. But shaitan must not make you think that that's good enough. No, that's a loss. Shaitan must not make you think that when we sit and talk about the seerah, it's only talking about history. No, it is so alive and it should be alive in our lives, because we should be practicing upon every aspect. Like I told you today, the issue of friends, subhanallah. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Makkah al-Mukarramah, when initially they started harming, do you know that the issue of hypocrisy in Makkah was nil? Nil. The muhajirin, initially those who had accepted Islam, they were free from hypocrisy. That's why Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الصَّادِقُونَ, when He refers to them. Those are the truthful ones. Because they stood with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the haq that they believed in so solid, in the face of the tyrants of Makkah, who not only threatened them, but executed some of those threats. They stood strong. So hypocrisy only crept up later on, astaghfirullah, when they went to Medina Munawwara and some of the people decided, like Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, etc., etc. They said, you know what, if we don't show that we're a part of this group here, we're going to lose out. So let's show that we're a part of the group, but we're not really a part of the group. Makkah al-Mukarramah, they were solid people. They gave their lives. Now I want to end with one aspect of the seerah that should bring tears to our eyes. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, we are in love with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no doubt. We are also in love with his companions. Because he says, لا تسبوا أصحابي فوالذي نفسي بيده لو أنفق أحدكم مثل أحد ذهبا ما بلغ مد أحدهم ولا نصيفه. Don't ever talk bad. Don't ever insult any one of my companions. For indeed, if you were to spend Mount Uhud's weight or size worth of gold in the cause of Allah, it would never equate a single handful of what they spent, nor a portion of it. Now I want to explain to you that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's companions were chosen by Allah. They were chosen by Allah. When you hear the name Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, something should happen to you. You should feel something in your heart. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, the same man whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, when Umar walks through a gully, shaitan cannot walk through the same gully. He walks through another one. Subhanallah. That is Umar. Can I tell you, they gave their lives. They gave their lives. Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu, he gave his life. Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, the uncle, the fierce uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, gave his life and he was martyred in order for the deen to come to you, and it has. So what are you going to do about it? We are sitting here today, thousands of kilometers away, thousands of years away from what happened then, and they gave their lives for the deen to continue, and we are sitting here today we are not prepared to give up 5 minutes of our time for the deen to continue into our children, our own children. Their concern was about the whole ummah. They didn't even know we existed. Our concern is not even about ourselves sometimes. Wallahi, they had more concern about us than we have about ourselves. They had more concern about our akhirah than we had about ourselves. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the only Nabi whom on the day of judgment he will be saying, Ummati, Ummati. The rest of them will be worried about Nafsi, Nafsi, because of certain things that may have happened. So that goes to show he is more worried and concerned about us and our Jannah and our akhirah and our future than we are ourselves. Many of us have so many bad habits, we are not ready to give up. Not at all. And yet they forget about giving bad habits up. They gave their lives up. You go to Uhud, a lot of us may be blessed to have gone there. And you see Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib's grave. You greet salam. Do you know what happened there? And you might know the history. Do you realize he fought for you and I? It came here today. We are seated here today. My brothers and sisters, I hope we can ponder deeply over that last point as well. And I hope that we can change our lives completely, because there is no point in saying tomorrow I'm going to change. It has to happen here and now. This was Allah who gave us such a great gift. Have we appreciated the gift of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? This evening, inshallah, we will be hearing many aspects, a lot of the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every aspect of it, ask yourselves, and I should be asking myself too, what have I done? What have I done to appreciate the fact that Allah has chosen me out of the billions to be an ummati, to be a part of this beautiful ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every single one of us. May Allah grant us goodness and ease. May Allah forgive our sins. May Allah grant us a new chapter, a beginning. For indeed, every time we gather in this way, the mercy of Allah descends. And we seek the forgiveness of Allah in such a way that when we get up, we will get up maghfoorin, totally forgiven by Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Aqulu qawli hadha wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammadin walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.